photographs and memories. Christmas cards you sent to me, all that I have are these to remember you. Memories that come at night, take me to another time, back to a happier day when I called you mine. But we sure had a good time when we started way back when. Morning walks and bedroom talks, oh how I loved you then. Summer skies and lullabies, nights we couldn't say goodbye. And of all of the things that we knew, not a dream survived.
My name is Tommy West, and I was one of Jim Croce's record producers, but more than that, I was his friend. The last 2 years of Jim's life were his biggest years. He became what I guess everybody would call a star. He had a lot of hit records, did many concerts, traveled around a great deal, and made a lot of friends through his music. He used to say to me, man, I really feel like I have a camera in my head, and I take snapshots of people. Well, those snapshots became a lot of good songs, and a lot of good stories. He was as good a storyteller as I ever saw. The one thing everybody should know about Jim Croce is that he wasn't an overnight success. He'd been in and out of the music industry for a long time. In fact, his first LP was turned down by about every major record company. Jim liked to be among the people in his concerts. He really enjoyed the fact that the everyday guy on the street could identify with him and knew who he was. And so what we brought together is kind of a photographic album of Jim Croce. And like all albums, some of the pictures may be a bit sentimental, others may be a bit frayed around the edges, but they're all warm and they're all real. And so is Jim Croce.
Well, I've had my share of broken dreams and more than a couple of falls. And in chasing what I thought were moonbeams, I have run into a couple of walls. But in looking back at the places I've been and the changes that I've left behind, I still look at myself to find. I've learned the hard way every time. My share of good intentions, and I've made my share of mistakes, and I've learned at times it's best to bend, 'cause if you don't, well, those are the breaks. Should have listened to all the things I was told, but I was young and too proud at the time, and now I look at myself to find. Learn the hard way every time. But in looking back at the lessons I've learned from the mountains I wanted to climb, I still look at myself to find. I've learned the hard way every time. I've had my share of broken dreams and more than a couple of falls. And in chasing what I thought were moonbeams, I have run into a couple of walls. But in looking back at the faces I've been, I would sure be the first one to say, when I look at myself today, wouldn't have done it any other way.
Thank you. You know, growing and spending a lot of time out in the streets, I really get to pick up a lot of the street talking all the time. Most of the way we used to talk, You know, people come up to you and say, you make any kind of trouble, Jack, I'm gonna cut you four kinds of bad. You know, I'm gonna cut you long, deep, wide, and often. And there's gonna be lots of sad singing and slow walking around your house.
That's when we were all wearing those pointy-toed shoes. We used to call them fence climbers. You know, back when South Philadelphia was the cultural center of the universe.
But I've learned since then to keep my mouth closed in a lot of these situations and always sit near the door.
It's a little pearl of wisdom I've learned at the expense of several bumps and bruises, funny eyebrow here and there, and a couple turns in my nose.
Uptown got its hustlers, Bowery got its bumps. 42nd, you got Big Jim Walker here. Two shooters on of a gun. Yeah, he big and dumb as a man can come, but he's stronger than a country horse. And when the bad folks all get together at night, you know they all call Big Jim boss just because. You just say you don't tug on Superman's cape, you don't speed into the wind, get on pull the mask off a old lone ranger, and you don't mess around with Jim. I don't do that, dee 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 dee. Well, out of South Alabama, come a country boy. He said, I'm looking for a man named Jim. I am a cool shooting boy, my name is Willie McCoy, but down at home they call me Slim. Yeah, I'm looking for the king of 42nd Street. He drive on a drop-top Cadillac. Last week he took all my money, and it may sound funny, but I come to get my money back. And everybody say, Jack, don't you know that you don't tug on Superman's cape, you don't speed into the wind, get on pull the mask of a old lone ranger, and you don't mess around with Jim. I don't do that, dee 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 dee. Well, a hush fell over the pool room as Jimmy come bopping in Norfolk Street. And when the cutting was done, the only part that wasn't bloody was the soles of the big man's feet. He was cut about 100 places, and he was shot in a couple more. And you better believe it's on a different kind of story when the big Jim hit that floor. Oh. Did he say you don't tug on Superman's cape? You don't speed into the wind. Get out the pole. Mask of an old lone ranger, and you don't mess around with it.
Yeah, Big Jim got his hat. Find out where it's at, not hustling people strange to you. Even if you do got a two-piece custom-made pool cue.
Yeah, you don't tug on Superman's cape. You don't speed into the wind. Get out before the mask of an old lone ranger, and you don't mess around with it.
And I was raised around a lot of that, you know, Fats Waller, and those old blues singers and the old cowboy Jimmy Rogers from back in the 30s. My father had a lot of those albums around the house. So I suppose, you know, that was all good time music. It was storytelling. The country music in the early days was really just stories. And that area, and looking at some of the other areas, I suppose it was the only kind of music I grew up around was either good time, fun music. You know, you're not the only oyster in the stew, and hearing Fats Waller sing it.
Jim's early style was traditional folk. He was kind of a synthesis of Woody Guthrie, Lead Belly, Pete Seeger, Ramblin' Jack Elliott. And he wasn't too funny either, because at that time he was too scared to be funny.
This land is your land, this land is my land. From California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me.
Tell me, what do people do when there ain't nothing to do, when there's nobody else around to do?
And by this time, he was singing a lot with Ingrid and playing in local places and doing some college dates on his own.
In a small town motel room where the diners all close at nine and the trucks keep a rolling by, and you just can't get to sleep even though there's nothing on your mind.
Tell me, what do people say when there ain't nothing to say? When there's nobody else around to help you pass the time of day?
During our college days at Villanova University, we used to play a lot at Jim's house. We used to spend a lot of weekends there playing folk music, and his father would say, you know, he says, what you guys are doing, it's really a lot of fun, he said, but don't ever let it become your job. He says, you're going to both wind up being bums. And that kind of set a little bit of a conflict in Jim and led to his somewhat indecisive feeling about being a professional musician.
You know, sometimes you find yourself in a situation, I know I've found myself there for a whole long time, period of character development where the job that you have doesn't always match up with the idea of the job that you think you should have, you know, and you get kind of depressed about it. I've had whole lots of jobs like that. This one especially has that feeling. The title of the song is so long that it would probably wrap around the album cover about four times. In fact, the title is the song. You know, it just kind of runs and runs and runs.
Well, I had just got out on the county prison. Tried to find me an executive position, but no matter how smooth I talk, they wouldn't listen to the fact that I was a genius. The man said we got all that we can use. Now I got them steadily depressing, low down, mind messing, working at the car wash too. Well, I shouldn't be sitting in an air-conditioned office in a swivel chair, talking some trash to the secretary, saying, hey now, mama, come on over here. Instead, I'm stuck here, rubbing these fenders with a rag, and walking home in soggy old shoes. With them steadily depressing, low down, mind messing, working at the car wash too. You know, a man of my ability, he should be smoking on a big cigar. But till I get myself straight, I guess I'll just have to wait in my rubber suit to rub on these cars. Well, all I can do is shake my head. You might not believe that it's true, but working at this end on Niagara Falls is an undiscovered Howard Hughes. So baby, don't expect to see me with no double martini in my eyebrow society. I got them steadily depressing, low down, mind messing, working at the car wash too. So baby, don't expect to see me with no double martini in my eyebrows.
One of the most interesting jobs I think I ever had was driving what they call a 15-gear semi-double-clutch and E-flat tractor-trailer van. And it involved getting up about 4:30 in the morning. But you have a good time doing that. You get to meet a lot of people, especially in the truck stops. Get a chance to meet these guys that are driving from Seattle to Key West twice a week, or Portland, Oregon, down to San Diego. You talk about some interesting folks. You learn a lot of tricks, too. You know, they cut off a broomstick about that long, put one end on the throttle pedal and the other one on the seat. This holds the pedal down to the floor and gives them extra foot to dance with when they really get into driving. They get into this, we put a couple tapes in there and just play and drive across the country. It's really a nice feeling. There's a whole, you know, ritual about that. I used to love practicing getting out of the truck. That was my favorite move, getting out of the truck and looking cool. So that the girl inside the truck stop could look back at me, you know? As she had her chewing gum over here and her snuff down there, had this tooth removed and had a cigarette up in there. She'd be doing all three at once and saying heavy stuff like, hiya, hon. I'm sitting there looking back at her. I remember the first time I swung out of there, I opened the door up, I looked her in the face, I swung down around the side, put one foot on the ladder, grabbed around and grabbed a hold of the white-hot chrome muffler.
Just as she's looking at me, I went like... took my hand off just like this, got back in the truck, you know, and went... took off, stopped in the next gas station, just held my hand underwater for like 2.5 hours, just going like... This is a song about the whole truck driving experience called Speedball Tucker. One, two, one, two, three, four.
I drive a broke down rig with May pop tires, 40 foot of overload. A lot of people say that I'm crazy because I don't know how to take it slow. I got a broomstick on the throttle. I got her open up and it right down. Non-stop back to Dallas, popping them West Coast turnarounds. Oh, and they call me Speedball, Speedball Tucker. Terror of the highway and all them other truckers could tell you that the boy is mad. You be driving in a rig like that. You know the rain may blow, the snow may snow, and the turnpikes they may freeze. But they don't bother old Speedball, he going any damn way he please. He got his broomstick on the throttle to keep his throttle foot a dancing round. With a cup full of cold black coffee and a pocket full of West Coast turnarounds. And they call it Speedball, Speedball Tucker. Terror of the highway and all them other truckers would tell you that the boy is mad. He driving in a rig like that. One day I looked into my rearview mirror and coming up from behind, there was a Georgia State policeman and $100 fine. Oh, well, he looked me in the eyes. He was riding me up. He said, driver, you've been flying. 95 is the route you were on. It was not the speed limit sign. And they call me Speedball, Speedball Tucker. Terror of the highway and all them other truckers would tell you that the boy is mad. You'd be driving in a rig like that. Yeah, they call me Speedball, Speedball Tucker. Terror of the highway and all them other truckers would tell you that the boy is mad. You'd be driving in a rig like that.
Introduce the band. The band is a really good friend of mine. Great songwriter, great musician. Maury Muehleisen.
Whoa, Rapid Roy, that stock car boy, he too much to believe. You know he always got an extra pack of cigarettes rolled up in his t-shirt sleeve. He's got a tattoo on his arm and say, baby, he's got another one to just say hey. But every Sunday afternoon he is a dirt track demon in his 57 Chevrolet. And he's a rapid roar with that stock car for he the best driver in the land. You know he said that he learned to race a stock car by running shine out of Alabama. Yeah, the demolition derby and the figure eight is easy money in the bank compared to running from the man in the Oklahoma City with a 500-gallon tank. And it's a rapid roar that stock car for he too much to believe. You know he always got an extra pack of cigarettes rolled up in his t-shirt sleeve. He's got a tattoo on his arm and say, baby, he's got another one to just say hey. But every Sunday afternoon he is a dirt track demon and his 57 Chevrolet. Hey, Roy's so cool that recent folk, he don't know what fear's about. He do 130 mile an hour smiling at the camera with a toothpick in his mouth. He's got a girl back home, name of Dixie Dawn, but he got honeys all along the way. And you ought to hear him screaming for the dirt track demon in his 57 Chevrolet. And he's a rapid roar that stock car for he too much to believe. You know he always got an extra pack of cigarettes rolled up in his t-shirt sleeve. He's
He's got a tattoo on his arm, I'll say, baby. He's got another one to just say, hey. But every Sunday afternoon, he is a dirt track demon in his 57 Chevrolet.
The beginning of Leroy Brown, as anybody who's heard any music last year might be able to tell you, and it was Jim's biggest single. And the introduction to that is kind of catchy and kind of sets up the rest of the record. And it was done in the office one day. Jim liked to write a lot of verses, but he was kind of bad at arranging his own songs. So we started to play some oldies, and one of the ones we played was Queen of the Hop by Bobby Darin, which is a big, big hit a long time ago. And it happened to be in the same key, and all of a sudden we went South Side of Chicago, and it just was kind of like magic, and it worked, and it even gave a new line to the English language. Jim Croce gave us the line, meaner than a junkyard dog.
When Jim hosted the Midnight Special a few months ago, he introduced a song called Bad, Bad Leroy Brown. On behalf of the Midnight Special, Jim, I've got something for you. It's your gold record for a million sales. Here you
Thank
go, buddy.
Thank you very much.
Proud to give it to you.
Really, thank you very much.
Could you do the song for us?
Yeah, I'll have to put one thing down even my guitar.
Give it
record,
back.
So I'll give you the record back.
We're proud of it. Thanks,
Thank you.
Jim.
Thanks,
okay.
Bert.
Well, the south side of Chicago is the baddest part of town. And if you go down there, you better just beware of a man named Leroy Brown. You see, he's standing by 6'4". All the downtown ladies call him treetop lover. All the men just call him sir. And he's bad, bad Leroy Brown. The baddest man in the whole damn town. Better than old King Kong. And meaner than a junkyard dog. Now Leroy, he a gambler. And he like his fancy clothes. Upon her, and her trouble soon began. And Leroy Brown had learned a lesson about messing with the wife of a jealous man. And it's bad, bad Leroy Brown, the baddest man in the whole damn town. The better than old King Kong, and meaner than a junkyard dog. Well, them two men took the fight to him, and when they pulled down from the floor, Leroy looked like a jigsaw puzzle with a couple of pieces gone. And it's bad, bad Leroy Brown, the baddest man in the whole damn town. Better than old King Kong, and meaner than a junkyard dog. But yes, it's bad, bad, bad Leroy Brown, the baddest man in the whole damn town. Better than old King Kong, and meaner than a junkyard dog.
I was I still have it. I have a whole street vocabulary, you know, stuff I picked up.
Yeah,
and heard. See, and I was working like from 1965 when I got out of school. Bang, immediately go to work at a black radio station, covering all the funky neighborhoods in Philadelphia you can think of. Trying to sell time to small jazz clubs and bars, you know. You really get into some stuff. I didn't sell too much time, but I sure learned a lot. I was out on the street all the time. Yeah, university of the street.
The better span in old damn town, the better than old King Kong, and meaner than a junkyard dog. Yes, he was better than old King Kong, and meaner than a junkyard dog.
Jim Croce's first national tour was with Kenny Loggins and Jim Messina, and we've asked Kenny and Jim to be with us tonight to sing one of their songs for you.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I think we must have spent an awful lot of time, you know, on the road with Jim. For what I can remember, we
how long
did a lot of dates with him, didn't we?
We went out. I know we went out two or three times with him, and he was my favorite opening act as far as openers go. He really got an audience feeling good by the time we went out.
You know, we did a date with him once. I think it was the Mississippi River Festival.
Yeah, Pine Knot.
Which was probably the best concert we've ever done with him, because there was like somewhere in the neighborhood of 7,000 to 10,000 people, maybe more.
It was an outdoor thing with like thousands of people, and it was night. I think maybe it was day when he got on, but when he got off, it was night.
That's the night he told me the story about. He was evidently a school teacher at one point, and worked with in a very poor side of town, and he said the school was so bad, I mean the kids were so bad in it, that they'd walk by and kick his car, you know. And after about 7 months, the thing looked like a raisin because it had so many dents in it. He said he finally got another car and parked it about 3 blocks from school, you know, so they wouldn't know which car was here.
They keep kicking the old one. Yeah. Jim and I and Maury, his side man, used to sit up after shows in Morgan's hotel room and sing songs, and he was always good. He knew
you
all
kept
the
me awake all the time.
Yeah,
I knew it.
Yeah, we did it all. One tour, we did it almost every night for about 3 weeks, and he knew all the old country bar songs, and he was teaching me all these country things, and I would teach him all the old Fats Domino things, and we would just mess with it, though. We'd have like 45 people in a room listening to the three of us play.
After he had that record called Operator, he was telling me one time that he'd get a lot of phone calls, you know, from all the operators when they'd hear his name and he was doing a concert. The midnight operator would give him a call and say, "Hi, how you doing?" He says that was a difficult situation. I think the first place that I met Jim was in an airport when they had first, I don't even remember which airport it was, but I remember what struck me as very incredible about the man as a performer is that he probably was, if he would have, his career would have been able to continue, he was sort of like the Johnny Cash, or would be the Johnny Carson that, of our generation. He would have probably went on, I'm sure, had a television show of his own. Extremely funny human being, and I was sort of expecting something like that to happen with his career.
It's because he knew everything about everything.
He was just one of those people that had so many experiences and was able to retain them. Mm-hmm. And the worst experiences, he was able to turn around and make funny, which made him what he was, the kind of performer that he was. Out of all the days that we've spent last year, especially on the road, there are very few times when you run across another human being that does the same thing that you do, which is to perform and make music. And God knows it takes at least 25 hours a day to do your job. Well, you run across somebody like that who can add a little bit of spark to your life, make you happy, and kind of get through what's a hassle about performing, which is getting from one place to the next. And I thank him for that. I think that was one of the greatest things he gave me. Not being an intimate friend of his, I can't elaborate as to what kind of a human being he was, other than the fact that he made me happy and made me comfortable. And I thank him for that. This one's for Jim.
And we were Jim's producers and worked with him from about 1968 until last year. On Jimmy's second album, Life and Times, there's a song called Dreamin' Again, and it's a ballad which deals lyrically with the way Jim wanted things to be, and we'd like to do it for you now.
Said you thought it over, said that you were coming. If I could save time in a bottle, the first thing that I'd like to do is to save every day till eternity passes away, just to spend them with you. If I could make days last forever, if words could make wishes come true, I'd save every day like a treasure, and then again I would spend them with you. But there never seems to be enough time to do the things you want to do once you find them. I've looked around enough to know just for wishes and dreams that had never come true. The box would be empty except for the memory of how they were answered by you. But there never seems to be enough time to do the things you want to do once you find. Looked around enough to know that you're the one I want to go through time.
Meeting Maury Muehlheisen really turned Jim's head around musically. Maury was a genius, and he showed Jim just how beautiful music could be. A short time after they started playing together, I received a tape cassette in the mail, and on that cassette was Time in a Bottle, Operator, and some of the other songs off Jim's first album. What impressed me most about that cassette is that Jim, for the first time, started to tell the truth in his songs.
This call. See the number on the medical gets old and faded. She's living in LA with my best old ex-friend Ray. Gosh, she said she knew it and sometimes hated. Isn't there the way they say it goes? Forget all that and give me the number if you can't find it, so I can call just to tell them I'm fine and to show I overcome the blow, learn to take it well. I only wish my words could just convince myself that it just wasn't real, but that's not the way it feels.
face this call. 'Cause I can't really know what you just gave me. Something in my eyes, you know it happens every time. Think about the love that I thought would save me. Isn't there the way they say it goes? Let's forget all that and give me the number if you can't find it, so I can call just to tell them I'm fine and to show. Overcome the blow, learn to take it well. I only wish my words could just convince myself that it just wasn't real. But that's not the way it feels. No, 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 no. That's not the way it feels. Operator, but let's forget about this call. There's no one there I really wanted to talk to. So thank you for your time. Oh, you've been so much more than kind. You can keep the dime. Forget all that and give me the number if you can't find it, so I can call just to tell them I'm fine and to show. Overcome the blow, learn to take it well. I only wish my words could just convince myself that it just wasn't real. But that's not the way it feels.
Jim's biggest fans were Richard and Karen Carpenter, and they have some special remembrances of him.
I sat across from him. The only thing I could see was that mustache, which has covered everything.
That's a terrific look. Yeah. I always enjoyed watching him in person as much as listening to the records. I'll tell you,
oh,
we
yeah.
went and saw him.
Well,
first of all, in one appearance was a Holiday Inn.
Oh yeah.
And
well, I love
each
the way
telling a story about each one.
The one with that's where he came up with that line about the chick that was so fat. In the backseat, she
you
know, after place.
You, right, after you reach 400 pounds. Up
after
to
you
then,
go
you,
buy a building.
After 400, you're a place.
Yeah. Beautiful.
Terrific sense of humor.
It's really, his music and his humor and that face is really going to be missed. It's sad, but he'll be remembered in a very good way, I think.
Yeah. Randy Newman. And they became good friends, and they really dug each other's music. And now Randy would like to sing a couple of his own songs for you.
Don't send me no young girl to love me with her eyes shining bright. All the young girls afraid of me. Send me a woman tonight. Don't send me no hand-holding baby. I've been babies before. Don't send me nobody that's crazy, Lord. Don't send me no young girls no more. Zach Zane, little girl, up in my rooms, Lord. With California wines, fresh perfumes, Lord. She started to talk me about the war, Lord. So I don't want to talk about the war. Taking night classes. Just send me somebody to love me. Please answer my prayer. Please answer my prayer. Please answer my prayer. I'll kick it down the street. That's the way to treat a friend. Right before me, signs implore me, help the needy and show them the way. And I think it's going to rain today.
Well, it's difficult to say. Jim and I were on the road together, I don't know, for about a year. I think he was just starting. And I think one of the things, I can't say one thing, you know, that I remember most is that he was a genuinely modest person. I mean, from the beginning, you know, to the end, when things began to really break for him, if I use a showbiz term. Some people are humble, you know, on stage, some kind of a fake humble act, and then in person they're not that way. But I think he was genuinely surprised at what was happening to him and grateful that he was there. And he never, I never can remember him complaining. You know, sometimes you travel, you know, under cramped circumstances in cars, you know, all over and the colleges and places like we were playing. And sound is bad often, and crowds were bad often. And he never complained about it. I never heard him. And that's a real rarity. I've never seen it in anybody else. And he liked what he was doing. Liked what he was doing. I think he always realized that it was better than driving a truck, and having had that experience maybe made him appreciate it more than some others might. And that's what I remember.
Stay tuned for a tribute to Jim Croce.
After about 10, 12 years of playing the Dew Drop-In circuit, the Elbow Room, the Blue Moon Cafes. Yeah, you see millions of those places. You get the picture of a place that's about a quarter of a mile off the road with a flickering beer sign in the window. three or four chrome-plated pickup trucks sitting out in the parking lot. And you work right on the floor, and they got you surrounded in a little chicken wire cage. So nobody hurts you with stuff that's flying through the air. One thing I've learned, though, is the guitar is really a great instrument of self-defense, you know. I used to play these great big old metal ones and have them custom made, you know, by Body and Fender dudes. They could really, where do you want the, you know, the beam? But it's really a trip playing in those places because you get to meet a lot of people. And a lot of the songs are about people that I've met in these places. I was working one night in a place where there was a girl sitting about 15 feet away from me. And I'm looking at her, and she's looking back at me. And I'm going, I'm sizing her up, you know? Because I had this rule of thumb about going out on dates anyhow, that up to 350 pounds, it's a person. And after 350, about 400, they become a place, you know? And I'm looking at her, I see that this woman is really interesting, because every time I get done playing, she's clapping, and I'm seeing this going like, you know? I mean, kind of like a turkey's neck. You ever seen that loose, whatever they call it under there? And I'm looking, she's looking back at me. She's got an ace bandage around her left leg. Got this bleach blonde hair piled up on top of her head in honor of the Dairy Queen. And I'm saying, I like this girl. I'm going to go and talk to her. So I stop down and I start talking to her. And turns out that she's from Texas, and she was in the roller derby. And I said, oh, wow, to myself. I was really into talking to her. And then her husband came in, the off-duty sheriff. He had that flat-brim hat on that I remember seeing down at Fort Jackson in Columbia, South Carolina, when I was in basic training. And the guy took the hat off, and he had that same haircut. He used to call it felt-tip pen, right down the middle of, you know. And I'm looking at him, and the sheriff's looking at me, and I don't want to get in any trouble because I can just see him filling out the report. You know, I fired three warning shots into the suspect's head. I didn't want that to be me, you know. So I just kind of worked around it, figuring, well, maybe I'll use my college experience. 4 years of college, I take English, philosophy, psychology, sociology, all these different ologies, and I came out totally prepared for life in the 12th century. You know, which is a funny experience. And as a result of the whole thing, though, I finally, after a lot of thinking, hard work, and some meditation about it, not wanting to get beat up, I got the song finished and didn't want the guy to really like beat me up. So we don't usually do it around home, but we're going to do it here. It's called I Fell in Love with a Roller Derby Queen.
Gonna tell you a story that you won't believe, but I fell in love last Friday evening with the girl I saw on the barroom TV screen. Well, I was just getting ready to get my hat when she caught my eye, and I put it back, and I ordered myself a couple of more shots and beers. Did I fell in love with a roller derby queen, around and round, all round and round, the meanest hunk of woman that anybody ever seen. Down in the arena, she was 5'6", but 215, a bleach blonde bomber with a streak of mean. She knew how to knuckle, and she knew how to scuffle and fight. Roller Derby program said that she was built like a refrigerator with a head. The fans called her Duffy, but all the buddies called her Spike. The night that I fell in love with a roller derby queen, around and round, all round and round, the meanest hunk of woman that anybody ever seen. Down in the arena. Could not help it but to fall in love with this heavy-duty woman I've been speaking of. Things were kind of bad until the day she skated into my life.
Well, she might be nasty, she might be fat, but I never met a person who could tell her that. She's my bleach blonde bomber, my heavy-handed hack-and-sack mama. The night that I fell in love with a roller-derby queen, around and round, all round and round, the meanest honk of woman that anybody ever seen. Down in the arena,
where Jim Croce would have gone musically is anybody's guess. But I kind of think that he was into an expanding process creatively. I'll never forget the look on his face last September when we finished his third album. We had just finished recording Maury's song, Salon and Saloon, and the look of wonderment almost said to me, like, gee, I'm really a professional and I'm really a singer.
Sometimes I think about our good old high school days. You would always kid about my adolescent ways. Oh, Mary, Mary, good to see you too. Haven't seen too many of the old, old crew. Time just flew, and how are you?
Stay tuned for a tribute to Jim Croce.
That it was bound to happen, it was just a matter of time. But now I've come to my decision, and it's a one of the painful kind. 'Cause now it seems that you wanted a martyr, just a regular guy wouldn't do. And baby, I can't hang upon no lover's cross for you. Gotta hand it to you, 'cause girl, you really tried. But for every time that we spent laughing, there were two times that I cried. And you were trying to make me a martyr. There's the one thing I just couldn't do. And baby, I can't hang upon no lover's cross for you. Tables are meant for turning, people are bound to change. Bridges are meant for burning, when the people and memories, they join all the same. So I hope that you can find another than take what I could not. He'll have to be a super guy. Oh, maybe a super god. 'Cause I never was much of a martyr before, and I ain't about to start nothing new. Baby, I can't hang upon no lover's cross for you. 'Cause tables are meant for turning, and people are bound to change. Bridges are meant for burning, when the people and memories, they join all the same. So I hope that you can find another who can take what I could not. He'll have to be a super guy, or maybe a super god. 'Cause I never was much of a martyr before, and I ain't about to start nothing new.
baby, I can't hang upon no lover's cross for you.
Don Kirshner was the first television producer to give Jim Croce national exposure when he appeared on the In Concert show. We've asked Don to join us tonight to give his own special remembrances of Jim.
Just a few weeks before Christmas of 1972, I received a call from Elliot Abbott, who was Jim's manager, and he asked me to put Jim on our television show. I had heard Jim's music and his songs, and I believed that he had the potential to become a superstar. When he arrived that evening at Madison Square Garden, he was one of the warmest and friendliest people that we had ever put on any of our shows. The current success of Jim's albums is phenomenal. He now has the number one and two albums in the country. You Don't Mess Around with Jim is the number one album, and I Got a Name is number two. Also in the top 20 is his album of Life and Times. I was privileged to know Jim. I considered him a friend, and I believe that his music and his songs and records will live on and entertain people for many years to come.
Moving me down the highway, holding me down the highway, moving ahead so life won't pass me by.
can't change me. I got a dream. I got a dream. Oh, I know I could share it if you want me to. If you're going my way, I'll go with you.
If Jim Croce ever would have an epitaph written about him, it probably would be, I hate to bring anybody down, because he really hated to bring anybody down. He said, I'm having a good time doing what I'm doing, and I'm going to keep on doing it.
You've had my share of broken dreams, and more than a couple of falls. And in chasing what I thought were moonbeams, I have run into a couple of walls. But in looking back at the places I've been, the changes that I've left behind, I just look at myself to find. I've learned the hard way every time. Cause I've had my share of good intentions, and I've made my share of mistakes. And I've learned at times it's been, cause if you don't, well, those are the breaks. Should have listened to all the things I was told, but I was young and too proud at the time. Now I look at myself to find, learn the hard way every time. I just look at myself to find. I learn the hard way every time. Cause I've had my share of broken dreams, and more than a couple of falls. And in chasing what I thought were moonbeams, I have run into a couple of walls. But in looking back at the faces I've been, I would sure be the first one to say, when I look at myself.